All right, for our last 17 minutes or so, let's introduce another kind of model. Both of our models today are ecology, effectively. It's called a predator-prey model, where you've got two interacting species, a predator and a prey. And we'll go ahead and use the book's example, robins and worms, right? Robins eat the worms, robins are the predator and the worms are the prey. W is gonna be the worm population, maybe on some farm somewhere. How many worms might there be in the soil of a farm? For sure thousands, maybe millions. Depends on how big the farm is, I guess. Let's go ahead and say in millions. And R is gonna be the robin population, probably more likely to be in hundreds or thousands. Let's just say in hundreds. Robin's going around searching for worms to eat. T will be time. Probably makes the most sense to do like maybe even days here. Now, I think I did days in the last class, but it probably maybe weeks makes more sense. I don't know how fast worms reproduce. You know, robins, it would be time scales of months for sure. Worms, do they reproduce in weeks? I don't know. Try to keep things simple. Let's write down our system of differential equations that possibly captures the behavior in the simplest way possible. It is a system of differential equations, one differential equation for each population. One differential equation telling you the rate of change of the worm population with respect to time, and one telling you the rate of change of the robin population with respect to time. And there's lots of different things you could try here. To keep things simple, we'll use the example the book does on the bottom of page 661. Let's let dw dt be w minus w times r, and dr dt be negative r plus w times r. What is our goal? Our goal is to figure out how the worm and robin populations change over time. How do we reach that goal? It's very difficult to try to reach it symbolically. If you plug these into DSOL value, even though they look fairly simple, it doesn't work. Can't be done. Even though they're fairly simple looking, there's a nonlinearity in both of those right-hand sides, and that nonlinearity makes it difficult. So what do? We take a qualitative approach. We just try to think about it carefully using some special methods to help us draw graphs of solutions. We draw those graphs in something called a phase plane. Phase plane. It is a plane. And you label the axes with the dependent variable names, W and R, not T. W here, say, and R here. Where is T? You could try to draw a T in here if you added a third dimension, maybe coming straight out of the paper, but that would be hard to draw. So we usually don't bother. Instead, we draw the solutions as parametric curves. Do you remember parametric curves? Like the Lissajous curves, for example, with vectors in came into play. Parametric curves, W and R both depend on T. And as T varies, you can draw a curve around in this plane, showing you how W and R change over time. And you draw an arrow on the curve too, showing you the direction of motion along the curve. We did that for Lissajous figures before. But well, how do you draw the curves? First thing you do is you try to factor these right-hand side functions. You set them equal to zero. Well, factor them first. There's a common factor of W here that can be factored out of the first one, and a common factor of R that can be factored out of the second one. Set these two things equal to zero and draw nullclines based on those. Now, we did talk about nullclines before. I mentioned that word. Null means zero. Clines means curved lines. It's short. That's an abbreviation, essentially, for curved lines. Nullclines. Our nullclines are actually going to be straight. Going to be some straight lines in this plane where these derivatives are zero. Now, you got to be careful. Where those derivatives are zero doesn't necessarily mean you have equilibrium solutions. You might, depending on where you are, but not necessarily. Doesn't mean if the derivative is zero, it doesn't mean the derivative is always zero, right? You can have functions that are that have a derivative zero at some point, but most of the points they're not, their derivative is not zero. The instantaneous rate of change at one point is zero, but it's not always zero. Like a ball going up and then coming down, when it reaches the peak, for one instant, the velocity is zero. But all other instances, it's not zero. So you gotta be careful. What are these nullclines? Focus first on when dw dt is zero. That can be zero in two ways. Either when w itself is zero or when r is one. By the way, we should briefly explain why this model is reasonable. Forgot to do that. Pretend there's no robins. Pretend r is zero. That equation goes away. What happens to this equation if r is zero? That term goes away. dw dt, the worm population, equals w. That's exponential growth. If there's no robins to eat the worms, they grow exponentially. And to keep it simple, we're not assuming there's a carrying capacity. On the other hand, if there are robins, they contribute negatively to the growth rate of the worms because they're eating them. Subtract this product. And this product gets larger and larger as both W and R gets larger and larger. And I'm subtracting it. So if there's lots of worms and lots of robins, dW dt is going to be negative. It's going to be lots of worms for the robins to eat. They're going to die off faster than they're born. Should I say born? What do worms reproduce just by, like, I forget. Okay. Are they really born? I don't know. What about if there's no worms? This equation goes away. And in this equation, that term goes away. Dr dt is negative r. That's exponential decay. There's no food for the robins. They're dying. Of course, they could eat something else, bugs. But remember, we're trying to keep the model simple. Their only food's worms. And when there are worms, it contributes positively to the growth rate of the robins. Yes, it's an oversimplification, but we're hoping it's a worthwhile oversimplification. Anyway, coming back to these nullclines, when W is zero, in other words, when you're on the R axis, dW dt is zero. If there's no worms to start with, there are never going to be any worms. And dr dt is exponential decay. Your solution will decay towards zero. Draw an arrow pointing downwards. dw dt is also zero when r equals one. Where's r equals one? I don't know, maybe it's here. Draw a horizontal line there. When R is one, dW dt is zero. Somehow, the rate of change of the worm population is zero when a solution curve crosses this line. What does that mean? We'll get there. Now think about the robins. Dr to t is zero, first of all, when r is zero, when you're on the w axis. When there's no robins to start with, there's never any robins. And the worm population grows exponentially. Make an arrow pointing to the right. Also, dr dt is zero when w is one. Say right here. Make a vertical line. Dr dt somehow is zero when w is one. What does that mean? We'll get there. There's two spots where both dr dt and dw dt are zero. The origin is one such spot. If there's no rabbits and no worms, there are never going to be any rabbits or worms. Robins or worms, excuse me. Another spot where both are zero is right here. If R is one and W is one, both rates of change are zero. And since they're both zero, they are both going to stay constant at one. These are equilibrium. You could call them solutions, but it's more traditional here to call them equilibrium points. I'm graphing them as points instead of ordinary graphs that are straight lines. Could I graph them as straight lines? Yes, if I made a t-axis go straight up off the paper and made lines parallel to that t-axis, that would be like graphing constant functions in this context. But I'm not bothering, right? T is just in your imagination. What do the other solutions look like? Let me draw them and then I'll explain. They are shaped, they're not exactly ellipses, but they are shaped kind of like ellipses or circles. They're circular, you might say. They end up looking like this, with arrows going counterclockwise. When you cross these nullclines, these lines, you have to cross them in a perpendicular way. Why? Think about it here with me. Think carefully. Okay, focus on this solution. If at a particular moment in time, I'm right here, both R and W are less than one. There's less than 1 million worms and less than 100 robins. What's going on? The populations are both relatively small, you might say. When that's the case, there's not enough worms for the robins to eat in the big picture. So the worm population is going down. R is going down. The robins are dying off faster than they're being born, while the worm population is increasing. Both, well, dr dt is negative and dw dt is positive. When, look at these expressions, when R and W are both less than one, that's a positive number, that's a negative number. Positive times negative is negative. Dr dt is negative, the solution's got to be going down. On the other hand, both of these are positive when R and W are both less than one and positive. Dw dt is positive, you're moving to the right because W is increasing. And when you cross this nullcline here, where W is one, that's an R nullcline, at that moment in time, the rate of change of the robin population with respect to T is zero. It's bottoming out before it starts increasing now. When you're over here, there's lots of worms and not a ton of robins yet. So the robin population is increasing. The worm population is still increasing as well. But once you get to this point, there's so many robins that now the worm population starts decreasing. You're moving to the left while the robin population starts increasing. When you're up here, there's too many robins, not enough worms. Now the robins start dying off while the worm population is still dying off. Down here, not very many worms for the robins to eat. They continue to die off, but now because there's not many robins, the worms start growing again. And the cycle repeats itself forever and ever, in the model at least. Does reality match this? Not exactly. Reality, if it's not physics at least, hardly ever matches mathematical models, right? You've seen that with COVID. All these people tried to come up with models for how COVID would spread. They were all wrong. That's to be expected. There are some that are better than others, but they're all technically wrong. But you hope you pick the model that's the best, okay? And if you did, then you maybe become a millionaire or something. I don't know. Or at least you become famous. Maybe. I don't know. It's part of the modeling process. Have a good day.